Hello and welcome to this week's episode of Talking Screwed. I'm your host, John, better known as Dale. We're on the X-Men. We have a fantastic show for you. Nothing is off the table when ArenaNet designs their raids. PvP League Season 6 right around the corner. But could we see automated tournaments in the future? And much more. But first, let me introduce you to my fellow host. He is a moderator over to MMO Champion. With PvP Season 6 coming soon, are you ready to hop back in and be the delivery man of pain? Say hello to Jim.
That depends entirely on whether or not I can actually manage to play classes. I was actually thinking about doing a dice roll system for what I play during nights, just to change things up on a regular basis. But, you know, show up.
Yeah.
0 to Hero, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, Wednesdays.
Awesome. And he writes over on his blog, agegaming.wordpress.com, where he answers the age-old question, with the ability to travel through time and space, correcting abnormalities in the fractals, when do you think we will get a TARDIS travel toy to ride in? Say hello to H.
When the golems and, what's it called? What's the Asteromian city? I'm tired.
Radisson?
When the golems and Radisson start saying, exterminate, that's when that'll happen.
Oh, my God, ArenaNet. Please, that's amazing. Anyway, let's not go down that rabbit hole. And you can see his stuff over on Twitch and YouTube at MMO Inks with all the topics looking at system changes. He is here to help us see the big picture. He is our Canadian bacon of Guild Wars 2. Say hello to Inks.
How's it going, everybody?
You ready to talk about all this stuff? Like, it just seems like this past week was possibilities of changing, you know, things like we said, possible automated tournaments, looking at the design of raids, so much so. Are you ready?
I have thoughts on the tournament bit, but I'm gonna save those for the actual part with the tournament bit, so.
Okay, well, let's jump into it so we can get to all the juicy stuff of the week and hopefully get to lore. I know people have been asking, and if for some reason, I'm just going to say it right now. For some reason, if we don't get to it, I think we are well past the spoiler rule here. So, you know, for whatever reason, you know, if you hit a spoiler somewhere, I'm sorry, people. It's been, what, 4 weeks now? 3 weeks? Like,
it's been a while.
Yeah. So, fair game now. But hopefully we'll get to lore probably afterwards. So let's talk about, first up, Guild Wars 2 Encounter. They basically showing how they designed raids. They had a blog post this past week, and they kind of referred to it as tabletops and chess, which definitely was interesting that they basically talked about conceptualizing the Mersaat Overseer fight, which was one of the encounters during the most previous raid. And they actually did have a screenshot of it and showed like their tabletop layout. Granted, it wasn't the fanciest, but it seems like it did what it needed it to do. But what are you guys' thoughts on, and did you enjoy the blog post talking about like behind the scenes and whatnot of the raid design?
Something like that. Oh, go ahead, Age.
Well, I was going to say, it was pretty similar. If you guys watched Guild Chat last week, it was pretty similar to what the blog post was, but more funnier because of the stories involved, but yeah.
Right.
I liked it.
I love the actual idea behind this. Just, it makes it a lot easier to conceptualize something when you can move things around, and just a lot of my RPG experiences in tabletop D&D, Pathfinder, a little bit of 3.5 and 4th edition for D&D, but You think in ways to break the game. Like, running table... Like, I actually had to use the Pythagorean theorem to determine if someone was within range for me to hit. One time.
Jeez.
Because I had to jump down from a balcony and run across a table. And proceed to dropkick somebody over a bowl of gravy. But that was neither here nor there. But it's one of those things where it's like, if you look at it like this, you have to think of all the angles, and then if you think about it within the concept of the system, well, the whole point of a lot of the cutting edge, like the bleeding edge raid PvP groups will abuse mechanics. It's not really, I'm not going to fault them for it unless it's like a very obvious glaring bug. Like one of the things that when they did the balance change for Alacrity and for Facet of Nature is it was propping up a lot of raid groups for boons, but it was a big problem in WV. So it was one of those things where it was a problem in one mode, was spilling over into another, and then they had to nerf one thing completely, and it just snowballs from there. But doing something like this, it lets you think like a player instead of thinking like a dev.
Mm-hmm.
So it's probably... I think this is the first time I've ever seen any dev team discuss about how they do encounter design like this.
This is definitely one of the more in-depth ones, which I really like the idea. I know it's not for everybody, but I like the idea of knowing how they decide to work on this stuff, how they visualize it, how they come up with the encounters, how that discussion sort of works. Fascinating, really. I love it.
Mm-hmm. And I mean, I'm glad like a bigger company's doing it. I've heard in the past from people that have like gone to school for game design and stuff like that would play like D&D or, you know, a role-playing game like that and kind of be like, okay, we kind of made the story. Let's, you know, see if we can make it into a game. It's kind of nice to see that a bigger company is like still holding that, because I think it's an awesome idea. It kind of always is like the thing, kind of like the opposite thing I'm always worried about. Like, I mean, granted, when they announced Warcraft the movie and they're like, it's live action, I'm like, oh, because it's like animated or, you know, something like that, it's, you can make people do the impossible, whereas if they're real people, they're limited by physics and reality. Where it's like this, you're creating in your head and then you're taking it to the computer. I'm definitely glad that they talked about it and that this is one method that I've heard used in the past from like more of so of students and maybe even indie developers. So
visualization is important.
Mm-hmm. Any other thoughts on the Guild Wars 2 encounter design?
Really, I would love to see more stuff like this. Just maybe not even just about encounters, but whatever, you know, having worked in R&D myself, any sort of visualization whiteboards or whatever that they use on just different things in the game, different development things in the game, you know. Don't get me wrong, like a lot of stuff happens via just simple conversations, but a lot of things happen via whiteboard conversations.
Yeah.
Just, you know, they write. And ArenaNet has shown some of that stuff from time to time, very briefly, where it's like the cow, like way, way, way back at launch, there was the cow catapult. And they had they drew a picture on the whiteboard or whatever of the cow sitting in the catapult and whatever their initial visualization for that was. And then they had little notes scribbled beside it for. That indicated whatever. I just love that sort of stuff. I love to see the behind the scenes, how they come up with these ideas, or maybe what the initial idea was and how it changed into what we see in the game. And I would love to see more of that, you know, more of that kind of stuff. Articles like that, I think, do well on the website and even in Guild Chat.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think we've always said in the past, we've always been a fan of the Guild Chats with, like, the Foley work. Basically any of the, like, the behind the scenes where you show their like the passion behind it. And
that was actually something that kind of disappointed me when Ghostcrawler left Blizzard, and this is going back to World of Warcraft because we were talking about that before the show. When Ghostcrawler left Blizzard, their communication, instead of being I'm a WoW dev and this is my Twitter account, all official tweets now go through Warcraft dev.
Mm.
So it's all filtered through a single account now. Right. And they have slowed down their communication with the public a great deal. Meanwhile, over here at ArenaNet, they're showing us, hey, we play D&D to do our encounter designs. And then they showed the Foley work, especially with the Phoenix Glider, with the fire, the Foley work with that. I am of the opinion that literally any behind-the-scenes stuff, anything to make your players feel closer to the content, either yes. in or out of game, is beneficial.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Matthew Medina is pretty good. He's a narrative story guy, but he, on his Twitter, from time to time, he posts little tidbits. Like he posted a couple months ago, he posted like an old map of Tyria, like an old conceptualization of what Tyria, back in Guild Wars 1, would have, you know, their original concept of what the land masses look like and how different it was. And it's just really cool to see that sort of stuff. And there's a couple of them that really sort of talk about, you know, that kind of thing. And you're right, it does. It connects you, a deeper connects you to the franchise and the game and the world, everything.
Oh, yeah. It's very hard to code in, like, passion, but I think this definitely shows that there's passion and care for it, that they're going to great, you know, great lengths, because I think they even talk about in there that it's like, oh, we had, I forget who they said, but someone whip up, like, the look or something of the Overseer, so they had, like, a more visual representation or something for when they were doing some of the things, when I was reading through the blog post, if I remember correctly, but it's like, you know, I think they did it, like, made it sound like literally, like, day of or within, like, usually, like, granted, I haven't been in a game design world or business, but usually when you ask for things to be created, it could probably take weeks if you need it at a rush. So for them to, what seems like in a shorter length, it definitely shows that there's that passion behind it. And so.
I kind of like how the recent encounters, not just in raids, actually, they're just feel like they're encounters you would see in other games. Like, for example, Nightmare Fractal I did with Malthus. I think it was it this week or last week?
It was just this past week, yeah.
Yeah. So it was like there was like a bullet hell segment part of it throughout that fractal, which was really cool. And that was the first time through Nightmare Fractal. It was actually pretty fun. So, and this Mirsad Overseer takes concepts of chess, like very basic concepts of it, and just implies it to an interesting raid fight. So, I'm kind of interested what kind of inspirations people will have for future encounters in the game, and just give that extra layer of depth to it, which has made the encounters really good. And so, can we see more of that?
Mm-hmm. Definitely. Any final thoughts on...
I like their tabletop meetings.
Yeah.
Keep up the good work.
If it probably wouldn't be, like, spoiler heavy, or maybe release at a later date, like, if they actually had, like, a tabletop, like, playthrough of it, I would love to see that. Like,
right, yeah.
Actually, play through a raid. Like, if they repeat, like, I don't know, Cairn or the Mirsad Overseer, they repeat it on Guild Chat again. Like, they keep bringing that back if they do something new and big.
Mm-hmm. Or heck, even just wait till after the raid and then release it as, like, oh, this is what we did and like, we recorded it. Like, I would love to see a Guild Wars 2 D&D themed, you know, session.
Convert the Guild Wars 2 professions into D20 RPG classes.
Yeah. But that's... Once again, we're going back to tabletops, and if they actually made a tabletop game, which I wouldn't be against, but, you know, let's focus on the game. Let's make it better, more powerful, and I don't know where I'm going with this.
Great again.
Oh, jeez. Ooh. Well.
Moving on.
Yeah. But you know, We saw a lot of people talk, like, apparently a lot of people are, like, playing WoW right now, which, hey, this is Guild Wars 2 podcast. That means we're going to fight. Speaking of fighting, eh?
See what I did there? Oh, my God.
PvP League Season 6 starts, and actually starts really soon, March 7th. So, yeah. What, next Tuesday? So, it's, like, yeah. I guess it's they really don't do a long break. It's kind of just, like, one after the other, but,
Is that a conversation we want to, is that a rabbit hole we want to go down on what they should be doing in the off season?
What they should be doing in the off season is implementing an actual ranked reward system that rewards people based on their finalized rank.
That's all I asked for. Yes, please.
They need to do something in the off season that is not just unranked.
Well, you can still play rank queue, right?
Can you?
Yeah, you can.
I think it still.
The problem is the scene kind of goes to sleep when season is not active, and I think that a lot of people drift away from PvP during that time. And ArenaNet has a very TikTok cycle currently with Living World, PvP, Living World, PvP, Living World, PvP. So. And I don't think that that's necessarily healthy for the game. I think that PvP needs to have its own cycle and comes and goes when it can come and go, rather than filling this void of, well, story's over, time to PvP, story's on, no PvP. And especially for the pro players too, the pro scene that they were trying to develop or that they had started to develop, I feel like in off-league season is the time to have those tournaments. Because you usually have a month or two or so between PvP seasons, and I think that you should run a couple of tournaments or a couple of pro-league tournaments or something during those times that can then overlap into the PvP season. Keep players engaged, keep them hyped, give them something to continue to watch competitively when it's not their own time to play competitive seasons, because otherwise nothing really happens in those off seasons. People just kind of hibernate until it's PvP season time, and I think that you're bleeding players between seasons as well, which is not good. It's not good.
It was a similar problem with WDub back when they had that. I think they had three tournaments with a few months in between. Yaxben World v World went to sleep outside of the tournaments. It's gotten better, but at that particular point, and this was like, what, 2 years ago now? 3 years?
Yeah.
How long has it been since the last WDub tournament?
Two years.
Yeah. Wow.
More than 2 years. Almost three.
But, it was one of those things where it's like, if you don't have something going on, even a little bit, like, I honestly halfway think that the PIP reward system should be available outside of the season. Maybe the rewards change, but you're still playing ranked. It's still supposed to be, this is serious.
Yeah, and it kind of loses that edge, right? I don't know. PvP is in sort of a weird situation where they...
And ironically enough, I think the way PvP was when WTS was around was actually pretty good. So you would have a kind of, I think, someone will correct me if I'm wrong, but let's say this is how they should do it. So if they put automated PvP tournaments or just have like a circuit where, you know, Arena doesn't have to really get involved, make ESL do it or something, and every small tournament or, you know, weekly, bi-weekly, how long you do it, you get points based on your performance, and then at the end of those performance, at the end of the circuit, whoever has the most points gets to go to the tournament, depending on like how many teams you want to send, and then you have a tournament either in-house or based on EU or NA or what have you, and I think that'd be a good way to do it. Just have one big tournament at the end. You don't have to go anywhere. People can play from home. I know it's not the ideal thing, but unless we have like a local server where people can play PvP. Unless they implement that, then it doesn't really matter. But.
Well, and this season's going to be interesting because they made a huge misstep with the way that you got PvP, the way that you got ascended rewards last season. Huge mistake. And I know that some people are like, but I like easy rewards. Shut up, Binks. Shut up, you're wrong. No, I'm not wrong, unfortunately.
I love everybody's internet voice.
Oh, I want to hear Aaron's internet voice and Ink's internet voice.
And now they're going to be in a situation where, and I wasn't even a big fan of that, but now that you look at the rewards with these new crafting tokens, and it feels a lot worse. I mean, it is a lot worse for obvious reasons because it was too easy to get before. But yeah. it really de-incentivizes the players from last season, right? Even though you can get more shards this season, the cap is very different from what it was last season.
People won't buy Zentium. Yay.
Personally.
Oh my god.
Personally, instead of going for ascended pieces, I'm just going to go for the skins. You can just get the skin itself without having to worry about the crafting tokens. So, I mean, the cost is the same for the armor. It's just minus crafting token.
Yeah. At least fractals is better, right? So.
See,
it's not like 56 gold plus something.
The thing that kills me about the changes to the rewards is there are so many other ways to get a box. A little, you know, pick and choose box, or just get random ascended gear as loot. And then you just use the stat swap Mystic Forge recipe, and there you go.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like crafting wasn't devalued before. It's not like these vendors are what devalued crafting. So. It's something Tavik brought up higher up in chat, is that the reward system, and that's what I said, like, Inks, when you put out your video about the season starter that I commented on it, it's, unless there is some kind of end of season reward system put in place that right. rewards more than just the top 250 people, and with something more than just a title, people aren't going to try and be good. They're just going to play their games.
Right. Yeah, and they're incentivizing. No, that's the wrong word. I don't want to say they're incentivizing losing even more, but they're rewarding losing even more if your game is within 80% of the enemy team. You get 200 pips. So it's possible now to lose the game and get 6 pips. You win the game and get 10, 11 pips you could get if you win the game. Like. You know, if I lose the game and I'm within 80%, I'm not so disappointed. I really don't care that much, to be quite honest. 6 versus 11, not that different.
Yeah. I find it kind of sad that they had to incentivize people to actually try.
Right, because they would just give up.
Yeah, it's like, oh, well, this is a loss. I'll just take my 4 pips and just AFK for the rest of this. And it's like, that's not what PvP is for.
Yeah. Okay, we're going to get into this. All right, so... all right, so from the very beginning, I thought that you shouldn't reward pips for losing at all. The near victory bonus thing is fine. That's totally fine, but I don't like rewarding losing. I know it's to incentivize people to keep playing, but if you're going to... Because... There are two mentalities that form because of this. One is the mentality of, you know, normal PvP. It's like you're playing to win, you're playing to improve, all that good stuff, you know, and, you know, minus the salt, ideally, but, you know, it happens. And then there's the mentality of you're just playing for rewards. You don't care really if you win or lose. You just play for rewards. And those mentalities don't coexist well in the same PvP sphere. It just doesn't work. And I've heard stories about people saying this person said legitimately said I don't care if I lose, I'm just playing for rewards, and that that doesn't sit well with me at all. So that's why I feel like you should just remove pips for losing, have the near victory bonus thing. I know maybe it might not be ideal for some people, but it's to keep PvP healthy. It's to keep it competitive, like a healthy competition. And the end of season rewards thing would actually help people to continue playing throughout the season. And so no matter what, either if you're in bronze or wherever, or if you're in legendary, it'll make you play throughout the season because you want to get that end reward chest and you don't want to decay down. You want that end of season stuff. So that's my spiel.
Yeah, I'm okay with top stats getting one pip, and I'm okay with near victory getting two pips, whatever. But they should remove the base three. Yeah, they should remove the base three just for losing. It's no, number one, it's too many pips for losing. Number two, I don't think it... You know, the reason that they did it was to incentivize PvE players. Just come try PvP. Even if you lose, hey, you're still getting rewarded. And I just don't think that... like Age is saying, I don't think those two concepts work that well together, because it fosters this environment of these two pips, unless you were doing fairly well and the scores is staying fairly close, that's the only reason players will continue to play. If it's a blowout regardless at the beginning of the batch, two pips is not going to press people to keep fighting. They're just going to say, you know what, still getting my three, I'm good.
Mm-hmm. And dimethyltryptamine in chat brings up a good point, is that a lot of the design in Guild Wars 2 is built to reward just playing.
Participation. Yeah.
And honestly, part of me is okay with it. Because in a world, and this is why they made all the big sweeping changes to the way the events run in the new hot maps, because there were a lot of them, like, you had to do an entire run of Verdant Brink to really get a lot of good stuff out of it. You had to do the full cycle of a meta event to really get rewards from it. So my thought there, you know, they broke it down, they made it easier to play in smaller chunks of time, which is great because there are people who just don't have the time. PvP matches, if we're moving over to PvP, 10 to 15 minutes. I've never had a game last, I think the shortest possible amount of time is 5 minutes. And that's if your enemy team does nothing. They let you take all 3 points right at the start of the game, and they don't even walk out of base.
Yeah. Unless you're playing Stronghold.
Fair point.
If you love Stronghold. Uh-huh.
I did one Stronghold match once, and then I got double juggled by thieves using Impact Strike, and I said nope. That was right when Hot released, and I was done with that. But I don't mind them giving rewards based on doing stuff. I'm even if the pip, like the flat pip reward, was one pip, and then you could get the plus one for top stats in a category, and a plus two or I don't even think plus three is great for near victory. Plus two would be fine. But if you do that, like two or three, if it's five possible, whereas a win is a base 10, I'm okay with that. Like, but still, you know, we're saying, like, even then, like, you make it either, like, anywhere from, like, 3 to 5 points are still okay-ish to me. But the pip reward track is more getting people there, not rewarding good play.
Yeah.
Like, that's why I keep bringing up end-of-season reward systems, because that rewards good play. That rewards people learning to rotate, learning to pay attention to their minimaps, learning class matchups, learning animations, learning audio tells. That promotes people actually trying to get better at the game. So that's my problem there. And without that, it's just, hey, go roll around doing next to nothing in a PvP match and get ascended gear.
Yeah,
it is worrying. I agree with like what you guys are saying and what like Inks first brought up. You know, basically incentivizing PvE players to kind of go in and do the bare minimum, and Like, granted, this hasn't incentivized me to go into PvP, and I will be the first to admit I'm a PvE player through and through. But I won't lie, like, when I needed to do, like, what, like, you know, the PvP dailies to get whatever the rewards were or something from the dailies, I would go and get, you know, basically try to do the bare minimum by going into those PvP or daily maps that people would make, you know, custom maps. Yeah. So I agree that that's a rampant problem. I'm a little saddened that they had to bring it to ranked to incentivize people. It's like, that's not good. You should be incentivizing the PvP players. Let the PvE players have fun in unranked and all that other stuff. I always felt ranked was that's where you're going to play PvP. You know, unranked, you're playing PvP, but you're paddling in the kiddie pool.
Well, unranked is also for, like, you're learning something, you're trying a new silly build.
Yeah. If you really want to incentivize PvE players into PvP, put a shiny in there. Put, like, a skin that you can only get in PvP. Because I know, the instant they put those wings in, I know quite a few people actually, like, who don't PvP actually went in PvP. And they're still, I know some people are still trying to get those wings.
The problem is that, and I know that players are going to hate this, right? It's against the Guild Wars 2 mentality. The problem is there are legendary wings that you don't actually have to be legendary to get.
Yeah, that's, well, at this point, it's like I've given up on that.
Legendary weapons and armor, whatever. But legendary weapons, legendary backpacks, legendary anything in Guild Wars 2 has kind of just become a meme. Because that's not legendary. It's not legendary.
Yeah, I've given up on that mentality at this point. Because at the very beginning, I thought the back piece should have been given out to people who have consistently gotten, like, higher levels, like diamond or legendary, when back when it was diamond.
Here's the other thing, too, about the legendary back piece for PvP. It's pretty clear that there's not going to be another legendary back piece for quite some time. Like, there's not going to be a new one for a while, would be my guess. Even though I think back pieces probably are easier to develop than, say, armor, or certainly armor, or maybe even weapons to some extent. And I just don't think there's going to be another legendary back piece anytime soon. So it's okay if it takes you several seasons to reach legendary rank to work towards that legendary back piece. Heck, maybe you only need to hit legendary once, you know, in order to get it. I don't know. I'm sure there's a good system in there somewhere. But allowing players to hit Sapphire and Ruby, and whatever the equivalent is now, Platinum, I guess, Platinum and Gold, you know, you're not even in legendary and you're getting a legendary back piece. It's just become this, it's not really legendary kind of thing. And if you try and suggest to players that it should be legendary, they say, no, because I can just buy legendaries from the trading post. Or I should just be able to grind open world and get a legendary. And I don't agree with that statement in the slightest. I've always had a problem since day one with the way that Guild Wars 2 handles their legendaries, and the system hasn't improved, really. The fractal back piece is okay. The raid armor, legendary armor, is pretty decent. Players hate the raid armor. They hate that it's locked behind raids, and they hate that the fractal back piece is locked behind fractals. And
I've had this discussion with some other people, and considering content, like legendary content, like the raid armor or things like that, I would say, just like, if you want it, just go get it. Don't, like, unless you can wait, forever, or you can wait till Arena puts out a different way to get it, or you can actually, you can whine about it. Sure, I mean, go ahead. But eventually, if they don't do anything about it, what are you going to do? It's either you get it or you don't. I know I don't like fractals. I don't like pugging fractals. I like doing it with other people. It makes it more enjoyable. People don't yell at me if I miss a piece of ascended gear and die every 5 seconds. So it's fine. I don't like pugging fractals, but I wanted the fractal back piece, and I did everything, including pugging. And, you know, at times I played fractals with, like, Inks and other people. And I eventually got all the stuff I needed to do fractal back piece because I wanted it. It's like, just, if you really want something, just go get it. If you want the back, if you want the raid armor, find 9 other people that want raid armor. And right. Just, like, find a cohesive group and just raid with them. Like, it might take you a while, but, you know.
And I think, like, you know, difficulty is such a subjective thing. So I might say something is difficult, and Mighty Teapot might say, well, you're just a noob. Learn to play, because it's not. You know what I mean? Picking on Mighty Teapot. But, so, you know, difficulty is subjective, but I do think that there should be difficulty points within a legendary track to make it feel more legendary. And weapons certainly don't come anywhere close to that, you know. Back pieces are subjectively, I guess, difficult, even though in PvP you really should have had to have been legendary to get a legendary back piece. Heck, in fractals, you have to do tier 4s, right? You have to go through that whole process. So fractal back piece is a little bit better. And then raid armor, even though, like Easy Roka is saying, a lot of it is open world based, you still have to beat some of the raid bosses.
I think you have to beat all of the raid bosses in order to get it, at least for the first three wings.
First three wings, you have to beat every boss.
I haven't done wing 4, so I don't know that whole process. But regardless, you know, there's difficulty there. Excuse me, in order to obtain it. So I think that that's actually a good thing and not a bad thing. I do understand that Guild Wars 2 has 3 game modes, and some of those game modes are not always supported very well. But it's difficult, I think, to, like, if you had World vs. World legendary armor, how exactly do you award that? By playing World vs. World, which can be manipulated very easily? It's such a difficult thing. I think there's a whole other conversation in World vs. World where that gearing system should be totally changed to be more PvP-based, but that's a whole other conversation. I don't even know how we got onto this topic of legendary weapons and stuff.
Rewards from PvP.
PvP League Season 6.
Well, what...
That's
what,
the script way. What, we got on the shinies and went from there.
What a rant off about something that has nothing to do with PvP anymore. Anyway,
we can table this for now and come back to it.
Yeah, I've gone on too long about something that has nothing to do necessarily with PvP, but anyway. I'm terrible.
Well, I mean, is anyone looking forward to Season 6?
I am to an extent. And the reason that I'm looking forward to it is because unless we see some new class-specific achievements, I can play whatever I want this season. Yay! I'm gonna reward hunt. I'm just gonna do what I need to do to get the rewards that I want. The question is gonna be, how many times do I want to repeat that last reward track? So depending on my level of frustration within the season, will determine how far I really want to go. You know, how many pieces do I want to unlock?
This season I started a month late, just because Overwatch holiday season was there and I wanted to do all that for all the shinies, but since there's none of that right now, I can actually try to progress a little earlier than usual. And I think I did honestly 15 actual days of PvP during the entire season. Not, I think that's including decay days, like days I just played to, like, stop decay. So, and that was like one match. So, yeah, I should actually try the season. maybe not have push days exactly, or have more push days, because I only had 3 or 4 of those. Yeah.
No, I'm just catching up with chat. But
yeah, chat's going off the rails in a completely different direction.
Yeah.
I'm going to follow up on age after you're done with your looking forward to or not.
I was going to say there's going to be more Condi. So that's going to be fun. That's going to be... I guarantee you there's going to be more Condi. Yay. Okay, I'm done.
Sad face. I'm looking forward to it in much the way that I actually enjoy having the skill meter to show where I stack up against other players. I kind of wish that existed for unranked, so I could at least see my unranked MMR.
Mm.
It'd be nice, but whatevs, yo. That's honestly the entire reason I didn't even finish my rewards. I was like 6 or 7 pips off on getting my final Byzantium chest from the season, and I don't care. Like, I did not care that I missed out on it, because the Ascended gear, I don't like the skins, and I can get Ascended gear elsewhere, so that's not a huge deal to me. I'm really just in it to try and get better as a player. That's about it. So I am looking forward to it. Yeah, that's why I'm looking forward to it myself.
I was going to say, I would love to talk about item level, but Kay brings up a good point. We've been waiting like 4 weeks to do lore, so we'll talk about item level stuff, because I do think that's an interesting topic for probably after show, or if we somehow rush through everything. But I feel like that's the only thing fair, because lore has been constantly getting pushed back for whatever reason. But
item level stuff.
Yeah, but item level is definitely interesting. And to quickly answer Netco's question about item level, it's basically your gear is now leveling, kind of like it's basically progression within a tier
to add more treadmill to your game.
Yes.
So if you love treadmill, then you love eye level.
Yeah, it's another tier. Like, it's basically tiny tiers within the top gear. So think of it as like legendary 2, legendary 3, legendary 4, but they're all legendaries. But anyway, once again,
yeah,
we'll
get into that.
Yes. Yeah.
Automated PvP tournaments.
Yeah, because I know a lot of people want to talk about that, so that's going to be another. So this past week, they talked, someone I think came up with the topic of basically automated PvP tournaments, and kind of, I think Inks was hitting upon it, like out of season PvP stuff. And a dev kind of responded in that forum post. We also think automated tournaments would be neat for viewership. We would have to re-implement the authorized shoutcaster program to allow certain people to stream the tournaments. And then they also said, due to technical limitations, we will likely never be able to add a delayed observer mode to Guild Wars 2, in reference to, I guess, people trying to cheat the system. But they definitely like the idea of automated PvP tournaments. I mean, would you guys?
Yeah, if you stream it, there's
the shoutcaster thing. Hmm? I didn't realize they did away with that. Apparently, they did away with authorized shoutcaster thing. Isn't that like Jebro in them? Weren't they authorized shoutcasters?
The only ones that I know, I guess, would be the shoutcasters who have casted. So there's Jebro, Storm, Purix, Munchables, and Kolaris. Those are the recent ones.
And over time, there were other people, there were other authorized shoutcasters that have moved to other games or work in other games now. I didn't realize they had did away with that system. Maybe they mean they did away with it because there's no active tournaments?
Maybe.
Sponsored by Guild Wars 2?
We really don't know.
I kind of viewed it as they were just on break. And this makes it sound like, yeah, we did away with that.
Yeah,
didn't tell anybody.
And you know, I'm fine with like them having an authorized shoutcaster program, like for, you know, like you said, like Jebro and, you know, a bunch of the other ones that, you know, constantly were, and like maybe having them stream through the Guild Wars 2 thing, which I think they did on occasion. But I like it almost makes it sound like if maybe I wanted to start to try to get, you know, into streaming, like maybe if I brought up my own thing and had like observer mode, kind of like what they had in Guild Wars 1, you could observe any, you know, things and kind of show people, it's like, hey, you know, I'm trying to, you know, be a shoutcaster and get your foot in the door. It almost makes it sound like you can't, otherwise you might be punished. Like,
yeah, I don't know. It's weird.
My thought here is that we got rid of the authorized shoutcaster system because there weren't any tournaments. And we're not having, but now we can't have tournaments because we don't have automated shoutcasters.
Yeah, I don't know. It's like a, right.
Yeah, this whole week's kind of been a horrible catch 22 because, like Chat was saying before, how, what was the Team Denial is, you know, a couple weeks ago, I think they announced, Hellseth announced at least that they were moving on from Guild Wars 2 and going to play Smite. And
I mean, if we want to talk about that, that whole thing is kind of like, there's a misconception in the community there, right? Mm-hmm. Because, number one, first of all, I fully understand and support Rom and Hellseth and the rest of those guys from Denial, and Vermillion, by the way, who moved to Overwatch. There's so two teams, actually. Because they're sponsored teams. They're paid sponsors. They have to play tournament games. They have to play competitive tournament games because that's what they're being paid to do. And I don't know what their sponsors pay them. I don't know how any of that stuff works. But they have to play a game in a competitive environment. That's why they're sponsored. If they're not doing that, your sponsor's just going to say, okay, it was fun. Let me know when you guys play again because maybe we'll sponsor you again. So they need to – that's not true. Well, they need to play tournament games.
I know for sure Hellseth said that the competition in Guild Wars 2 just wasn't there as team-wise, so that's why they're moving on to another game.
Oh, I see what you're saying, is that their sponsor was not making them play. Sure, okay, that's fine, but as a competitive team, you want to play, is my point. So they want to play in a game where there's a competitive environment, where there's an active competitive environment. Yeah. And Hellseth's video was all about the fact that they're waiting for word from ArenaNet on when the next tournament is going to be, or what are they doing with leagues, Pro League, or what are they doing with Worlds, or what are they doing with anything, and they weren't getting responses.
Yeah.
So teams are going to move into an active competitive environment. Now, Hellseth has since still played Guild Wars 2, and he even said if they bring tournaments back, then, hey, we're not opposed to coming back and playing again. But there needs to be something for those guys to do.
And that's what I was kind of going back to, like you guys were saying. It's once again a horrible catch-22 where, you know, the pro players are going, well, I have no one to compete with, and I would like tournaments. And unfortunately, you know, ArenaNet or NCSoft are probably looking at, well, they're not getting high enough views for PvP stuff because you're not supporting it. You know, it's that horrible roundabout, like. So, yeah, it's throughout a lot of the game modes, we're kind of in this weird catch-22. But I think that's with everything.
Yeah. For Guild Wars 2 in particular, if they really wanted to make it an eSport, they'd have to do a bunch of things that they just currently don't do or they can't do for some reason. For example, skill balance needs to be on the ball. Like if something is really, really strong, they need to fix that soon, and you know they'll take a month and they'll actually try to fix it because you have to balance for two other modes as well. So that's just a hard thing to do, and there's probably other things as well. But honestly, I would just like ArenaNet to just come out and say like what they want to do with Pro. Like, I don't want to, because as far as we see it, like, everyone is probably seeing it as, like, there's just no more Pro League. There's just no more tournaments. And I don't want to be, like, 6 months later, they announce, like, some huge WTS or something. I'm like, what? But
well, and here's the thing. If they do that, let's say 6 months from now they announce Worlds 2 or whatever they want to call it, those teams will come back to play. It's not like how Seth said, done forever, guys, it's been nice, you know what I mean? The crux of his video was, hey, if they do something, we'll consider coming back to play. I mean, he's not going to make a promise or a guarantee necessarily, I don't think, but they would still consider coming back to play. But in the meantime, we're going to also play this game, and because we think it closely relates and we could be good at it, you know? And you can't blame them for that. They want to play an active, competitive game. They're competitive people, you know?
Mm-hmm. That's fair.
I mean, yeah, kind of going back to earlier in chat, everybody was apparently playing WoW or maybe some other game. Like, for right now, if Guild Wars 2 is not suiting your needs of whether it's competitive PvP or PvE or, you know, World v. World, yeah, go to another game.
I need it so badly. It's so good.
And as I say, like Ink said, the nice thing is, and that's the nice thing for Team Denial or any of the teams or any person, since Guild Wars 2 doesn't have that gear treadmill, people can easily come back and still be at, you know, that level. Now they might have to get refamiliarize themselves with, if, you know, skills or whatnot have tweaked or changed or... Yeah, it's
interesting. This conversation gets rather... This is a little derivative, I apologize. But I've been recently following the Magic the Gathering Pro Tour scene. And there's a huge... And there's two sides in that scene where there's a huge current discussion about the validity of the Pro Tour and how many viewers it brings into Twitch. Because it's streamed on Twitch now. And they don't see that many more viewers than like a Guild Wars 2 Worlds, let's say. Magic might pull in, and somebody's going to correct me, but they might pull in 5 to 10K people who watch, maybe. Now, for a big pro scene, that's really not that many people, right? If you compare it to League of Legends or something, let's say, which is massive. So the question in that scene becomes, okay, well, not that many people are really watching it, and does the Pro Tour really bring new players into that game? And the argument is, people are saying, no, it doesn't actually bring new players into the game. The other side of the coin of that is that, okay, maybe it doesn't bring in new players, but it satisfies the veteran players or the experienced players who have been around forever. So the question then for Guild Wars 2, I think there's a similar question there in that... You know, maybe they don't make a bunch of money, maybe it doesn't even attract a lot of new players to Guild Wars 2, but does it satisfy those who enjoy PvP? And you have to ask yourself as a company, is this enough, you know, are we seeing enough return on satisfaction and not necessarily monetary gains?
Yeah. This is going to be my last point because I know Dale wants to talk about lore, but
I think Chad wants to talk about lore.
Yeah, everyone wants to talk about lore, but especially Dale. I know if you put in automated tournaments, I feel like the scene for Guild Wars 2 PvP will be satisfied with that. I know it's not ideal. Ideally, you would like a Pro League circuit as well, but, you know, if there's automated tournaments, at least teams will be satisfied, and overall the PvP scene will be satisfied with the performance, and then they'll just be salty about skill balance. And, yeah. But, yeah.
So, overall, yay or nay for automated PvP tournaments if they could properly implement them? I mean, like, out of season, or...
It could only help. It can only help the scene.
Please let us beta test.
Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of people made a lot of Guild Wars 1 references in that forum post. So if you're watching this on YouTube, the link for the forum post will be in the description. But yeah, a lot of Guild Wars 1 reminiscing. But let us look at the gem store. First up, let's talk about this whole month, March Madness. Apparently sales every day. We're going to get to the lore. Don't worry. I still feel obligated, like we have to do the spoiler thing, so it's going to be at the tail end. So, but we're going to be not that many heads up for it because of the, it's been 4 weeks. But anyway, so the gem store March Madness sales every day, and apparently this today, if you're watching this Saturday live, is the replica Jabotron backpack, the Dread Quiver backpack, and the plush Quaggan backpack cover. So the Jabotron backpack is 250 gems, which is 50% cheaper. The Dread Quiver backpack is 175 gems, which is 50% cheaper. And the plush Quaggan backpack cover, which is 150 gems, which is 50% cheaper. But, 50, yeah, so...
50% off is good.
Yeah. Like I said, it's every day, so if you're watching this on Sunday, it's going to be completely different. Why it pays if you wanted those three to show up live. But I'm curious, what do you guys want to see out of the March Madness sales and also chat?
Google Gem Store real quick.
I'm honestly not sure what I'd like to see, but I'll keep an eye on it. I'm kind of half expecting the bunny ears and the cat ears to show up again at some point, because those are always massive sellers.
So what would make me spend money? Account unlocks. Inventory slots. Not for me, but character sale. Character slot sale. I don't need any more, but people will always buy more. I don't need more characters, but I need more characters. People will spend money on that, especially if it's on sale. Account material storage upgrade, which is something I would spend money on. I think they had a bag slot sale one of the days already, yesterday maybe. So bag slot sales, bank slot sales, those are the kinds of things that I'm interested in personally. But
oh man, I hate to burst your bubble, because apparently, and I know some people in our chat's gonna love it, people on the wiki have actually kind of looked at previous years when they did the March sales, and right, kind of tried to figure out maybe the pattern to it. Now, granted, like I said, this is just a pattern, always subject to change. You know, this is just them looking at the trends of the last years, and they did say, you know, if you look at past sales, bank slot expansions and character slot expansions are unlikely to be part of any future March sale. Supposedly there is one finisher offered per sale, one of the two permanent passes, which now we have a lot more. So you might see like the Captain's Airship Pass, the Royal Terrace one, the what was the one in Ring of Fire?
Lava Lounge.
Yeah, you might see more of those, and like I think there's still like two more, but those might be popping up. They said maybe around St. Patrick's Day, which is the 17th, they usually do item boosters. And they also said at least one skin is offered within the span of 7 days. Most of the items are usually discounted by 20%. Unless they really don't think it's going to sell well, then you usually see 50%, which makes it kind of interesting, because those three right there are 50% off, so... Maybe they don't have high hopes.
Makes sense.
So, I found an item I want.
What do you want?
They're sport sunglasses.
Oh, yeah. I mean, those haven't been in the game in 3 years.
I don't even remember seeing... Are they like Ray-Bans, basically?
Yeah.
This item was removed from the gem store on December 17th, 2013. We've never seen it ever since.
They were a... They were an outfit thing, right? I think
it's a skin.
Well, I think now it is.
It is now, but originally.
Yeah.
Was it one of the...
There were like three or four sets of glasses that got removed, and there's two of them that still haven't been brought back. One of them is the ones Age is talking about. Mm-hmm. I would probably... hate to think I would buy them, but I would probably buy them.
I think I did that with like the bunny ears because it was like they're back and they don't know when they'll ever come back. So yeah, that might be like a knee-jerk reaction there.
They would make money. I mean, they would. People would buy them, especially if
cool guys.
Some people would be upset because I think it would be like a flash sale, right? I think it would be a 24-hour thing. But listen, Age, log into the game every day. Do your dailies, and you won't have a problem. Then you'll see the sale.
I do. For me, it's not a problem. I just don't like flash sales in this game. I don't know.
I think a lot of them are...
all the March sales are 24-hour.
Yeah.
So far.
Yeah, I know this is probably going to be the bigger topic of them, but let's look at what is new in the gem store instead of just returning stuff. And always thank you to Dolphy.net. Check out Dolphy.net so you can spend your gems more wisely. And if you're playing other games like we've seen in the past, I know she does has stuff for like Black Desert Online. I think she does Elder Scrolls Online, like multiple other games, so it's a great source for information. So just check out Dolphy.net. But we have the Bram Wolfblood Pauldron. So kind of saying what chat was saying, like, oh, they just use reskins. Well, this one kind of, yes, but no. It's they basically took the Bram Wolfblood outfit and basically just were able to extrapolate the pauldrons, and now they are an armor piece. They said they said it couldn't be done.
They figured it out. They cracked the case. Good job.
But yeah, you
now
can pick up.
How people want. It's so amusing. I love it. I love the conversations on Reddit about this. It gears me up. Where's my bottle of Ellie tears? We can add Wolf Blood Shoulder tears to that bottle.
But you can get this for 300 gems, so if you...
I think that, unfortunately, I think in the future, I think that there's a great way that ArenaNet can implement this without causing such a ruckus in the community. I think this particular one was handled... I think it's just a... I think that the shoulders weren't ready when the outfit was ready. So I think in the future, they can provide the outfit and shoulders and whatever else that they can clip off the outfit. They can offer those at the same time in the future, and it won't be quite as big a deal, because then people can decide, look, I only want the shoulders, I only want the helmet, I only want whatever they can clip off of the outfit. Or you can just buy the outfit. The unfortunate circumstance here is that they sold the outfit, and then several weeks later, they were like, you know what? You have the outfit. Here are the shoulders as an armor piece. Please give us more money. And people are like, no, it should be included. How dare you, ArenaNet? You have forsaken me. My family will hate you forever and ever. I will tell my children about this injustice. No, it's not that big a deal, really. I understand why some people... Yeah, a curse upon you. I think in the future, if they release an outfit and the shoulder piece or whatever else at the same time, that's fine. I think it's a little bit ridiculous that some people suggested you should give us helmet, shoulders, gloves, boots, whatever, plus the outfit for 700 gems. You shouldn't charge us extra for anything.
No.
It's all included. How dare you, ArenaNet? Give me free shoulders. I already paid for the outfit. And that's just silly. It's just silly. Come on.
If I saw an outfit and I paid 800 gems for the outfit plus 2 to 3 armor skins, 800 gems for the outfit plus the armor skins, I'd be okay with that. And you know, if they wanted to go super gung ho on it and give us all 6 pieces of the armor set, whatevs. Okay, fine. You just got super, like, the art team went super crazy with it, and they just churned out all 6 pieces.
Yeah, I was confused for a second. When you were going on your rant, I was like, what's wrong with that? And then when you said for just 700 gems, I was like, okay, that's where it's, yeah. Like, honestly, I would like if down the road, if they were able to say, here's an outfit armor bundle or whatever they want to call it, where, you know, it will have the individual pieces, but also the outfit for the people that are just leveling up. Like, I understand the people that want outfits. I'd rather have armor, but I understand that people want outfits. I would like to see that for somewhere around 1,200 gems. Like, I feel it would be a little bit less than buying a set of 800 gems was usually the going price for an armor set, and 700 was the outfit. So that would put it to around 1,500. So, you know, maybe closer to the 1,500 mark. So it's like a bundle set, but you still have the mix and match option. But I think 700 gems for a full set of armor and outfit is a little bit. Yeah.
First of all, you're paying 800 for a regular set of armor when that was a thing they could do.
Yes.
Which they don't even do anymore. And they have discovered that they can a la carte out the pieces and make more money, so you ain't getting it for 800 gems. As much as you might want that, it ain't happening. They're charging you 700 for an outfit that you don't even want. So, good luck.
What's interesting is that I feel like they could charge more for like a full set of armor that was an outfit. Like, if they put out the Bram out armor, they could probably charge like 1,000 gems for that, and people would buy it still.
Oh my gosh. The first time they did it, people would flip out. They would go crazy.
If they put it at the same time, people
would get used to the price. That's just how it works. That's how it's always working in Guild Wars 2. They raise the price on you, people like me flip out, and then eventually you just accept it because they beat your will down. They crush your soul under the weight of that Bram armor, and you just buy it anyway because you're like, I hate you, but I want this.
Yeah. Like, hey, you wanted the armor. There you go. It's more expensive now, though. So, I feel like they could, and I guess I'd be okay with it. But I'd expect it, to be honest. But
I never really bought the one-off pieces unless it was clearly wasn't going to be part of a set, like, you know, like the sunglasses or this or that. Like, those are when I bought the one-off pieces that would, like, accentuate, but if, like, when it was, like, clearly a set or possibility of more of it coming out, like, I could definitely see the shoulders, like, if the shoulders sell well, I'm sure they're gonna eventually try to piece out the rest, if at all possible. And if they're going for, like, 300 a pop, it's too rich for my blood for one set of armor.
Three pieces, 900.
I mean,
pieces, 1,200.
Yeah, I mean, if they do all six pieces, it would come out to 18.
Well, here's the problem. I don't think they're going to do six pieces because legs and chest seem to be the problematic parts of the armor. Clipping off shoulders, clipping off a helmet, clipping off gloves and boots seems to be semi-doable, at least on some level for them. Clipping off the legs and chest piece, for whatever reason, seems to be the problematic part. Generally speaking.
Yeah.
If you look at the other gem store pieces that are out there, it's everything but chest and legs, right? So, for whatever reason, those are the problematic parts, it seems like.
Yeah.
Maybe someday. Maybe someday they'll discover the rest of the technology to piece it all out.
We have the technology. We can build it.
Or just like they've always had in the game where it says, if you equip this, it hides this portion of the armor, no matter what it is. Just saying. Not bitter, just saying. But before chat riots, let's get to the rest of the gem store stuff so we can get to the lore. I can't believe I'm being forced into the lore. Holy crap. But if you are a fan of the Wolfblood Pauldrons, if you want to still pick up the outfit or whatnot, they brought back the Bram Bitterfrost Frontier Pack, 2,000 gems, which is 20% off. You get 5 Frost Eye kits, a total makeover kit, Bram's Wolfblood outfit. Now, that is the outfit. You can hide the helm and, you know, it's all or nothing. Air's Legacy Longbow, which is a skin, and Minigarm, which is Air's Wolf that, well, I guess, you know, it's been a while. I guess now it's Bram's Wolf. but it has
don't
a mini.
Necessarily, we don't necessarily know if Garm will like running around with Bram.
True.
And maybe Garm likes rocks and frostbite now.
but you can pick that up. One of the other thing, returning items, Bram's heavy armor skin. Now this is an armor skin. If you can see it right there on the left there, it's kind of his old, you know, look when right. He had hair. 640 gems, 20% off. Some stuff that is leaving Tuesday is also, you can see Bram's mace skin for 600 gems, Bram's shield skin for 600 gems, the jungle explorer outfit for 700 gems. Remember, that is an outfit, so it's all or nothing, can hide the helm, and the mini Bram Arison, miniature you can see right there for 350 gems. Would you recommend any of those to players if they don't already have them?
I have the mace and shield.
Yeah, I have bought the mace and shield. I have his outfit, the helmet, the horns on the helmet scale on Asura, so they're gigantic.
Glorious.
That used to be the helmet that I wore on my guardian all the time because it was ridiculous looking. So if you have an Asura, they can wear heavy armor.
Yeah, those do absolutely look ridiculous on an Asura. It's scale, the helmet scales on a Asuran like pauldron scale on a Norn.
Yeah. Gigantic.
But yeah, I am very fond of the Bram mace skin and shield skin, so I would definitely probably recommend those as well.
Yep.
Especially if you're running a Norn character and can use a mace or a shield. But I think that is it for this week. Until we get into spoilers, don't calm down, everybody. We're good. This is going to be the only warning. We're going to... I feel even bad putting up a spoiler tag. But if you want to run away now, if you haven't been playing for, three or four weeks, at this point, it's on your own. It's
Kate
on your
actually
head.
Informed us that it has been 4 weeks. She's been counting.
Oh, okay.
Wow, it's been a whole month.
So, yeah. I'm not even putting up a spoiler tag. If you haven't gotten to it, you're clearly not playing... You know,
watch
Guild Wars 2.
A person had a business meeting in Japan for a month and came back and decided to watch the show. That'd be
oh,
hilarious.
Well. Oh, well.
They knew what they were getting into, and this is enough of an ample warning where they can walk away. All right, so let's talk about just the story so far. This last update, Head of the Snake. Jeez, now I'm trying to remember all this stuff. So, I think the biggest shocking thing is there was no Casimir in this episode. There were slight references to her, but not, like,
yeah,
I think before this, we were all like, Casimir has to be in this. This is a Crichton thing. Like, but, yeah.
Yeah, I thought so for sure. Yeah, even my cat is like, where the heck is Casimir?
Well, he's doing it from the home instance. That's why there's a cat.
Yeah.
But, so, basically, pre-story, Timmy notified us that Rox was able to convince Bram to make an exploratory group before going into, you know, go after Jormag. That's basically the previous one. But, story-wise, we have to go meet the ministers and all this. It seems kind of calm, and then the sword gate breaks... Stuff hits the fan, and yeah, ministers. A lot of the ministry people are white mantle in disguise and start attacking us, and we have to basically get Queen Jenna out of there. And then sure enough, boy oh boy, Queen Jenna is.
Queen Jenna gets us out of there.
Yeah, because we basically get frozen in place, and then Queen Jenna's like, nuh-uh. And she uses mind bullets and just messes up people. And I'm not going to lie, I think, like, if we were playing SWOTOR, there would have been dark side points on my side, because when she, like, mind bullets, like, the guards next to Minister Estelle, and then the one runs off, I was like, get him, kill him. And I was like, whoa, yeah, where'd that come from?
I thought she was going to. I thought she was gonna zap him, zap the last one.
I was just expecting to hear a scream from, like, behind the pillar as he runs off. I was like, she doesn't even have to see you, she just knows you're there, and
fatality. I played that episode with my friend. When we saw that, we were like, "Oh!" And the next person, "Oh!" It's like, she's gonna not stop. Gonna kill them all.
That was surprisingly dark, to be honest. Yeah. And I think season 3 has kind of gone a little Game of Thronesy on us.
It's always been like.
Not nearly.
Inks has gone a little Game of Thrones on us. If you've heard some of the stories, man, he's like, kill everybody.
That's right.
It's like people die, and it's not like it. This is just people just like, don't care. Nobody cares. It's like they don't even have a name tag. Just lie down and just throw your weapon away and lie down on the floor.
Yep.
Well. I feel like it's always been Games of Thrones, because if you look at, like, very first personal story, second half of it, like, people are just dying left and right.
Yeah. I don't know, it just feels like all the season 3 deaths have more weight to them, for That's some true. Reason.
Who's died so far?
Demi. I mean, she kind of didn't have much of a point to a part to it. There have been other people that have done,
I guess Cauticus is good, but we're getting ahead of ourselves.
Actually, you know what bugs me the most about that death is because she got shot, right? And we go to fight Cauticus, right? In that time, couldn't Anise portal her out to, like, a hospital or something? She portaled out to tell Logan that ready for the assault, comes back. Like, why can't any of these OP mesmers use their portal to
save? Because they're all evil.
Apparently, like, everybody, almost everybody in Tyria is a mesmer. They're just everywhere at this point. There are so many of them. You got random guards and the queen and just Anise. They're all mesmers. Everybody's a mesmer, apparently. They're all over the place. And they're all better mesmers than the... than the player character.
Man. Yeah. I can't... Yeah, we've had... Mesmers are OP. That's what this episode told me.
I will admit the feedback bubble over DR was kind of an oh shit moment. Like, that was a really cool cinematic that was well done.
You know what's really interesting about that is I feel like that... So it didn't surprise me because I've read the books. Mm-hmm. I've read Edge of Destiny.
Yeah.
And I feel like most players probably haven't read that book, which is fine. I mean, I didn't really expect them to, but players were kind of shocked at the kind of power that Queen Jenna possesses. Now the finger bang, the mind bullets kind of did surprise me. But the giant bubble over DR didn't surprise me. I mean, in the book, she summons an illusion of Krakatoric and has his minions chase them over the hills, so to speak. So the fact that she can put a bubble over the city doesn't necessarily surprise me, but she is one powerful mesmer, that's for sure. And clearly, you know, what's really interesting is it apparently has taken Logan this long to figure out that she doesn't really need him as much as he thinks that she needs him. You know what I mean? And I really love that realization on his part. Better late than never, I suppose.
She's a strong, independent Cretan woman who needs no man.
That's right.
You have to do the Z-snap now, Age.
Well, I won't lie. When Logan came walking up after she just mind-bulleted, like, the guards, I just had a feeling, like, he came up kind of being like the Padme going, "You're going down a path I can't follow."
Christ.
And that's why she left the other one go.
And then we end up going to Alona. There's sand.
I get my desert sword. I get my desert legendary sword.
Yeah, but sand, it's coarse and it's grainy and it gets everywhere.
Just irritating.
That's what makes it the perfect legendary.
But I kind of feel that was necessary for Logan's character development.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because for the longest time, he's been this, like, love-struck little puppy who is basically like, my queen, my queen, my queen. And sure, even in the personal story, he has a bit more development than that, but really his overarching driving purpose to exist is to defend queen and country.
Right.
And, I mean, a lot of people, because I like how Netcode's actually saying Logan will come running back and all that stuff. It's kind of interesting that it happened after he was spoiler for Hot, he was in a blighted pod. And it's kind of interesting. A lot of people's theories about how he always went back to Queen Jenna no matter what. Like, basically, main story of Guild Wars 2 was, at least with Destiny's Edge and through the dungeons, trying to get the band back together because of what Logan kind of screwed over the party throughout the book, in the books. I'm wondering if, and a lot of people have run with this idea of like Queen Jenna maybe use mesmer magic or some kind of thing to keep him like a love-struck puppy. I wonder if the blighted pod did corrupt him enough that it canceled out this magic.
I honestly feel like she didn't use any magic.
She's evil.
It's interesting. She used her woman wiles on Logan. Her using magic on him is like an interesting concept. In the books, the first time he sees her, it's like such like a classic. I don't know, a classic movie representation of, that one woman. The first time he sees her, she comes to L.A., and Logan is a pit fighter with Ritlock and Kaith, and she sort of strides up to greet the crowd, and she has this, otherworldly glow around her, this golden glow, and he's just awestruck immediately by her beauty. So he, like, instantly falls in love. And she sort of facilitates this throughout the book with letters that they send to one another. Logan constantly says, we're going off to fight this dragon champion. I really wish I could be by your side. And she's like, oh, me too, Logan, but you got to do what you got to do, And she's like, I hesitate to allow you to go as my champion, because she chooses him as her champion. But I know that you have to do this for the betterment of Tyria and blah, 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 whatever, So, and then one day she finally does call on him, and of course he drops his friends, his guildmates, everybody to go and
destroyed everything save for her. The betterment of Tyria.
yeah. To go and save her when it's debatable whether she needed saving then as well or not. I guess she sort of did, because she needs a quiet space to summon Krakatoric Illusion, but yeah.
And it might not be even Queen Jenna doing, like, I think there might have been some kind of magic involved, but maybe it was, like, from a niece. Niece, we saw a little bit of a dark side in this episode. I mean, she was against to me. As an Whispers person, I was like, she's good, you leave her alone. Like, I was ready to fight a niece at that end of that story. I was like, as a Norn in the Order of Whispers, I trust to me, I barely know you, Anise. You about to get punched. I was
You're going to be okay there, Dale.
No, I'm not going to be over this. That's bull what they did to me.
Yeah.
I actually, was talking about the meeting of ministers just as an instance for the story, I actually kind of like the fact that they reward, like, their hostages to free, their guards to res,
I didn't even realize they were achievements, and I almost finished a couple of them just on the first run through because I'm just running through and rezzing people as I go through because, I don't know, overworld PvE stuff just kind of has that ingrained in me. Oh, hey, person's down, rez them.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. The first time I played through, I ignored all of them.
You're a terrible person, Inks.
Can't help you protecting the queen.
Well, I think help. That's one of those things is you kind of feel like you have to rush to the throne room.
Right, yeah.
Like, you don't feel like you have the time to stop and look around and do stuff, which I think is good for the storytelling in general. So, there's that.
Yeah, it... And I agree with Chad. Yeah, she... Anise was more, you know, kick butt and kind of, like, in your face mode. But, man, why'd she have to aim that at Demi? Like, aiming at Caudicus, the guy we were after.
Well, yeah, she's the daughter of the head of the stake. I mean, how much can you trust her?
Yeah, well, I'm 2-0 against dragons, and I said she was good.
I'm gonna side.
You know, apparently most of Tyria doesn't find that impressive. That
yeah, I know. Seriously, it's like I killed two dragons. Yeah, but could you move some bales of hay? It's like what the.
Yeah. Listen, I know that you've killed two dragons, but my golem is overheating and I'm kind of lazy. So can you fix it for me?
Yeah, it's like that's great and all, but can you dance in front of my cows outside of in Queensdale? Like what? Anyway,
what I really love about that Asura at the portal there is, besides the voice acting, which was really well done, if you fail fixing the golem, he basically just says, oh, just give it to me, I'll do it myself, you know? kind of berates you a little bit, kind of says, you're trash, get out of the way, I'll just do it myself.
Yeah, I think that was me the first time. I was like, what am I supposed to do? Oh, I already failed it.
And if you're successful, you sort of like take a shot at him saying, I'm glad I could do your job for you.
I like that show. Those are
really good. I have not done it on a vigil member. Is there like any special dialogue or chat or?
I don't think so. I need to go through on a few other characters.
I'd be surprised, but
I think there is at least at one point there is some vigil dialogue, I think.
Huh.
But yeah, and I love how in that instance I get so offended, you know. First, Timey basically calls us an idiot every time we talk to her, and then the queen basically calls us Bram. She's just like, oh, your life must be so easy. You just go around smashing things. Yeah, that's us. We have no nuance whatsoever. We just smash everything like Bram does.
I was like,
how dare you, Queen Jenna? I don't care if you are the queen and don't wear shoes anywhere you go.
We're more than just a weapon.
We're more than just a blunt hammer that goes around smashing dragons.
We have ideas.
Yeah, we also bash. We also bash the dragons.
Oh boy. And we just play into it. We don't say anything. We're just like, yeah. Wouldn't it be fun to run around with us, Queen Jenna, smashing stuff? And she's like, yeah, I guess, whatever.
You're secretly like carry us.
Get out of here and go with Logan to the gate.
to be fair, we as the Pact Commander definitely have a lot more freedom to just kind of go out and
just do whatever we want. Problems.
So she's not wrong. Though I kind of tend to agree that it's just like, hey, there's a little bit more than just like, oh, there's a problem, let's punch it.
Right, yeah. Heck, that's what we're trying to stop Bram from doing, right? We're like, hey, Bram, maybe punching it in the face is not the best idea to start with. Why don't we try Timey's idea first? And the queen's just like, oh, it must be so liberating, just go around smashing stuff.
Jenna's critter rampage. Well, in this story, we end up confronting Caudicus, and eventually, you know, we actually defeat Caudicus, which I was surprised we did. It was...
10 of 10.
Why is that? Because it was it... Do you feel like it was rushed? type of deal, or was it out of the blue type of deal?
I felt it was rushed for what every other thing we've done in Guild Wars 2, where it's like the last fight inside the like main room, and then he escapes in a fireplace, and they're like, and then what is it? Wee comes down and goes,
Valette.
Yeah, Valette comes down and just says like, oh, I know like how to take care of him. I'm like, okay, well that's gonna be the next one. All right, and then yeah, it's right here. Boom. I'm like, wait, what? Wait, we go now?
Yeah, I don't know. There's definitely, I've talked about this before. I think the episode should have ended with him escaping. Give Cauticus a little bit more time to create evilness and to be consumed by his blood shard. Instead, he just goes and does a little bloodstone in the back room, and he's ready for fighting right away instead of, you know, maybe an episode later. But I think it's, unfortunately, on ArenaNet's side, I think it's a matter of
time,
how many episodes they need to fit in total, and not, like, stretch that story out a little longer, even though I think it should have been stretched out at least one more encounter with Cauticus.
I actually am totally okay with dealing with him at the end of this, because after going through the entirety of the manor and reading all of the letters to and from Cauticus from all the various people, which, you know, if anybody in chat hasn't gone and done that, I highly recommend it, because all of those letters are super enlightening. But I feel like this is another instance, kind of like the raid storyline, in that we as the commander have not been seeing this happen. Like, we have not seen the development of this storyline that is Cauticus' descent into madness, and we saw him snap. Like, him killing Demi was like the last, him raising his gun and shooting her was just that last bit, and he's gone. Like, he has succumbed to the madness, and that's what we run into in the Willy Wonka bullshit land of his basement. Which, I say Willy Wonka bullshit land, I love the visual effects in the basement. I absolutely love stuff like that. Like, there's actually a piece of artwork in my office in, like, a common area near a training room that is a similar thing to the...
That is Cauticus's giant face?
No, it's not Cauticus's giant face, but it's a similar optical illusion. I would have had a few problems working there if it was Cauticus's face, but...
Oh,
actually,
boy.
I don't know if I'd have problems or if I would have thought it was awesome.
I'm asking you, Malthus.
Yeah, really. But I think that it was a good end to what amounts to a minor villain.
I don't say
minor villain in that he's not impactful. I say minor villain in the fact that our major villains are the dragons.
Yeah. I had no problem with it either. I think the room, the last room, could have been a little bigger.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
But I had no problem dealing with Cauticus there, and then it was kind of interesting, but it depends how many episodes they plan to do, which people are speculating it's going to be 6, but, you know.
I don't know. I feel like... I feel like we're missing a few steps, because when he leaves in episode 1, it feels like he goes to get weapons. But then we see those weapons now. We missed that whole part where he went to get weapons in the Isles of Xanthir.
And those are the cannons that we're talking about.
Those are the cannons, the White Mantle themselves are a bit more geared up in general, and... Yeah, I don't know. I think that they're... And maybe they'll go back and tell that story. Maybe they'll reference it in letters and stuff later. Who knows? Because the White Mantle are not broken. They're not scattered or anything like that. It's just that Cauticus is dead now. I don't know. I do understand what people are saying. It feels a bit contrived, but I think that there's a little bit of extra story there with Cauticus where he still has... the extra Lazarus item, perhaps. Valette is now going to help us find him. Like, the story itself doesn't necessarily change. The pacing just changes a little bit.
And yeah, because I think that was her words, rushed. Was like, she was like, I want to help you find him. He's right here. Right. It's like, whoa, oh, wait, what?
The other thing is, his, you know, you were talking about, like, let him perpetrate some more evil. Well, if his officers in his faction of the White Mantle are loyal to him, loyal to the cause he set forth, they're going to continue his plan. If not, we're going to see a fracturing of that particular facet of the White Mantle as there's a power struggle, and there's going to be chaos. And since they're an overtly antagonistic force at this point, that chaos is going to manifest in them attacking things. So even in death, Caudicus has set forward events that are going to cause problems for Tyria, which I'm kind of okay with. It's one of those things where it's like, I'm kind of okay with an anticlimactic note for a villain at points, just because it's kind of against the grain, for the most part, to standard media for a story. I don't mind seeing him snap, and it's not like, you know, he escapes as this bloodstone monstrosity and goes out and wreaks havoc upon the village, the town of Beetleton, and, you know, the surrounding Crichton homesteads. It's having him put down now feels maybe not as satisfying as it could have been, but fitting in the venue that we stopped him from doing as much as we could have.
Yeah,
you know, that makes sense. Yeah, the more you got, like, you guys talk about in reading chat, you know, I guess I'm trying to impose Guild Wars 1 White Mantle, and like, no, they're a big part of the, like, I still think they're going to be a big part, but I think this leads to a more scary version, because I think we've said before, like, before we knew about the whole Lazarus thing, like, we were like, the Lazarus White Mantle are going to be like the Guild Wars 1 White Mantle, because they're still in that beliefs and all that stuff, whereas Caudicus's were like the political White Mantle of, We just want to take over, you know, dethrone the queen. Like, he was going to use them as a tool. I think now we're going to see a more traditional White Mantle, I guess, of like Guild Wars 1. So yeah, maybe it's going to be more crazy. Hopefully.
And I think Most Excellent has a good point too. If we just had maybe another mission or so in the episode, that would have differentiated it enough for me.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that fight in his waiting room, in his living room, I guess, and then you just immediately go into his secret dungeon basement monument to himself, and he's bloodstoned out, like, right away. I guess it just felt a tiny bit rushed to me. It felt like we missed a step, but yeah, I mean, if it was in a separate instance, then with a little bit more dialogue or something in between, then maybe it would have, like, maybe it would have felt a little better. Like, maybe if you go to his bedroom and you read everything that you read in the bedroom, then you're like, okay, we got to get him right now. We can't let him get away. You know, where is he, Valette? And then she says, okay, follow me to his secret dungeon, his secret evil lair. Maybe it would have felt a tiny bit better, you know? Maybe the pacing, for me, I realize not for everybody.
No, I kind of agree, and I think a lot of people have hated the original pacing, but it was like throughout the other seasons, it was like, you know, oh, we need to figure this out. Okay, go around the world and collect this, or do these like tasks, sure, which
yeah,
made it sound yeah, like that's what, you know, Valette was doing. She was like, I can help you guys. And I was waiting to be like, okay, here comes like a go around, collect these things, or talk to these people about this thing. But it was instantly going, just go through the thing. It's like, you mean the thing we just literally saw him go through? Okay, I could have thought of that myself. I mean,
it could, too, just be the teleport thing, right? She says, oh, yeah, I'll take you there. Here's a teleport. Go through
yeah,
it. Maybe if we would have, I don't even know. Maybe if there's a, you
know, I would,
the fireplace moves to reveal secret dungeon passage, then maybe even that maybe seems a little bit cooler for some reason. I don't know.
I would have assumed that it would
it was more like a Mesmer thing, like there needs to be someone who can access the portal.
Right. Yeah.
So that's why she was just able to be like White Mantle secret portal frequencies. You're good. Go.
Now is Cauticus a Mesmer?
I am honestly not sure.
I guess not, because he asks for a portal from her in episode one.
And he never really overtly displays any kind of ability save for when he's hulked out on Bloodstone.
Right. Yeah.
He's got a rapier and a pistol, so maybe thief if we want to give him a player class.
Probably.
So that's really about it.
Yeah.
I have two things. One, is anybody going to use the mask for anything?
No, I don't like it. I'm not a big fan of masks.
I actually did. I use the Cauticus mask on my ranger because I always make. I for some reason I've made my druid like the White Mantle thing. Because when I was raiding more frequently a couple months ago, I made a White Mantle look. He has like he had the Bloodstone mask. He had the White Mantle staff. I dressed him all in white. It's great. So I'm like, oh, Cauticus mask, boom, and it matches his hair. And it's great. God,
it's just so creepy.
Exactly.
It's like I had this the exact same reaction that Kanak had. Is that a mask of his own face? And it's just like the only person you know of that can be so narcissistic in Guild Wars 2 to have a mask of his.
See, that sort of lends more credence to the fact that I think there should have been another step, right? Because, okay, he's Cauticus and he looks like Cauticus, but then he hulks out on Bloodstone and he no longer really looks Cauticus-like, so he needs a little face mask to look more Cauticus-like. Do you know what I mean? It's kind of like the classic villain thing where his face is hit by acid and now he needs to wear a mask that looks like his old face or whatever. I don't know.
I don't know. I feel like that's more... I think it's one of those things where it's like overt versus inferred for storytelling. Like, I think that a lot of the stuff dealing with Cauticus and the White Mantle is inferred, but, you know, that's one of those things that kind of works with the White Mantle because they've been working behind the scenes for so long.
Hmm.
So...
Or maybe they can do a Negan thing where they were like, I am Cauticus. No, I am Cauticus, and they'll have little Cauticus masks.
Oh my god. If that's a thing, it becomes the Guy Fawkes Cauticus.
How creepy would that have been?
No, they could do that. They could do that afterwards if the White Mantle are still together. They could.
Wait. So part of some kind of award ceremony, think a la End of a New Hope from Star Wars, Jenna's presenting us with some kind of medal for helping defend the city of Divinity's Reach, and then everybody in the audience suddenly has the Cauticus mask equipped.
Yeah, there you go.
Oh.
Are we doing some, like, weird V for Vendetta thing? Like,
that's what I was thinking of. Like, because I said it's like the Guy Fawkes mask of Guild Wars 2 now, and it's just like...
I was going to say, what if, like, his essence is in there and we go, like, Fable style? It's the Jack of Blades mask. It's in the mask itself.
Most Excellent Hat brings up another good point. There is a White Mantle Mesmer who is admiring...
Yes.
...an illusion of South Sun Farron. Who, he's when you walk into the room...
Jungle Farron.
Oh, Jungle Farron. I'm rich,
yeah, you know. Jungle Farron.
Yeah, I think when I first was playing through and I, like, opened that door and I was like, ah, wait, what? And then all of a sudden it disappears into butterflies. I'm like, oh, jeez, are you... No.
And she's actually neutral. She's neutral for a half second.
Yeah.
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 And then she goes hostile. It's just like, you saw nothing. Stab.
This. And that's one of the things I love about just Guild Wars 2 in general, but this particular episode, one of the reasons that it's my favorite, all the little details, you know, the letters from E, the Cauticus letters, the Bloodstone Cat in the instance, the Jungle Lord Farron, the picture of Logan, the mirror on top of the bed, all the dialogue from... I was going to say Cauticus, from Kanak, the different profession-based specialties that you can employ, you know, the turrets turning skeletons, the ranger hounds, all those little things really add up to a great story, a great instance, for me anyway.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, Codicus definitely stole the show. Like, he was just... he was saying what I think everybody was thinking.
Is totally, like, Codicus stealing the show is kind of the point.
Yes.
He's always been one of those larger-than-life style, like, am I a villain?
Mm-hmm.
He totally is, but it's like, people still follow him because he's charismatic. Also, for the setting, I am totally happy that I don't want to say I was right, but like, I'm happy that they started doing this. They utilized the manor, the dungeon map, as a story instance.
Right. Yeah. Which
I'm okay with this. It's amazing because it's a map that they have. I want to see all of the dungeon maps still get used in current stuff. I don't want to see those just kind of mothballed away into legacy stuff. Because there's a lot of work that goes into those maps. Like, we deal with... if we start dealing with Jormag, I would love to hit Honor of the Waves. And maybe we, like, free it and it becomes some kind of city that we work from to fight Jormag.
Mm.
I don't know. It would be interesting. Just the more they can use those instances, the better.
Mm-hmm. Do we want to talk about the story of the raid and then probably think of where the story might go? That way we kind of cover all the bases.
I've actually tried to avoid the story on the raid. I haven't looked at anything. I haven't looked at anything on it yet, but I don't know if that's because I've been avoiding it per se, but it's just I haven't had the time to read it, and I'll go back and look at it. But We can talk about it, because I'm probably not going to get in there anytime. And I think I killed Deo.
Yeah.
I think it might have something to do with that rock, pointy rock. What is it? The
Abaddon's Eye. Eye of Janthir.
Yeah, that's it.
You called it a pointy rock. Fucking.
The pointy rock.
I'm hurt right now. The pointy rock.
It's a pyramid crystal, Milthanis. You gotta get it right.
It's got several points on it, then.
Well, I mean, do you guys want to talk about the raid thing? I mean, it's...
I'm in.
Sure, let's do it. Let's talk about it.
Okay, well, Bash of the Pentenance.
I don't think anyone can say that right.
I was thinking in my head, I was like, I can't get it wrong, but I haven't even said it for like the past 3 weeks. So basically when you go in there, you actually find out that you're on, like, if you look at the map, once you go in there, you're on like the shore, like on the southern shore of the, like, I think it's the, like, Lake of Janthir. Basically, you're pretty much in the Isle of Janthir. You're up where heavy old Mursaat territory, supposing maybe that's where the White Mantle been hanging out for all these years. But places that we've never gotten to see, so hopefully we venture up there. But as you kind of travel through there, I only got to the first platform because I haven't raided, so... But you can actually pointy rock.
He's still over it.
The I can't get out of my the Eye of Janthir is kind of just sitting there, and it's I think I noted during one of the after shows when we were talking about it more freely, but it's kind of interesting that it has like a, like in at least in the first area, I don't know if it's in the subsequent bosses, but the Eye of Janthir is actually, there's also like opened celestial sky, like basically a star pattern. I don't know if it's a portal or just like an opening in the ceiling, but it's like like kind of streaming into it as well, which, you know, it doesn't look like so much of a night sky. It just looks like open space. That's why I thought of it more of like a portal instead of it didn't look like a sky. Like there wasn't clouds going across it or anything like that. I'm pretty sure it was just like almost, you know, a starry, like spatial sky. But I definitely found that intriguing. We can talk about that kind of stuff for, you know, where we think the story might go. So basically, the raid, you fight a Karn, which basically a Jade Armor type boss, a Mersaat Overseer. There's four bosses, right? I can only think of three.
Four. Samurag, and then Deimos.
I was thinking
Deimos.
Yeah, I was thinking of Deimos.
I seem to mispronounce it. So.
Yeah, basically a big demon thing. But what's really interesting is at the end, you basically free someone. Someone kind of crucial, if you're a fan of Guild Wars 1. And actually, I think I still have the cinematic. Huh?
You want to guess? Go ahead, guess, Dave.
Oh, yeah.
Who do you think it is?
Olivia.
No, sorry.
I don't know.
You want to take a crack at it, Jim?
I really like Olivia.
Oh, it's Saul.
Oh, yeah.
Saul Delicio. I mean, Delicio.
Yeah, I totally just watched the cinematic while you were doing it.
Wow.
Well, I was going to say, I actually have the raid thing here. Yeah, so if people want to see it, there it is. I never updated this thing, so let me get...
Gilroy Stonekin, that's who is it. Oh, wait, no, it's all we already said. Okay.
But... there we go. Had to fix the... anyway. Yeah, so we finally find out what happened to Saul, and this has been 250 plus years, I mean, because he disappeared before, kind of right before the events of Guild Wars 1 that we deal with. And basically they were just keeping him alive, but to go quickly back to, and this is kind of one of my theories prior to the release, was it could involve Saul in some way. And like I said, and I stand by it, I am fine with it involving this is the side story, because it wasn't even a main story in Guild Wars 1. It was already an event that happened. So I know for me, I was like, I'm fine with this, and that's why it was such the Mersaat thing in the first raid. I was like, but we were involved. We chased them down. That's why it was like so much more, you know, involved for me as a Guild Wars 1 player. In this one, like I said, it was always a side story. It was always background information. I mean, granted, there was the bonus mission pack, but I mean, I don't really consider those to be warranted as like, oh, well, they were in the game and, you know, it was just kind of showing it.
What worries me a little bit is that during Guild Chat, the last Guild Chat they did, I think it was the last one they did, they talked about how they really sort of had to sort of fight to get this story into the raid to begin with. And if this story wasn't told in the raid, then they wouldn't have told it at all. And I know that there were a lot of complaints, especially when the raid was first released and the revelation that it was about Saul and his story and what happened to him. People were not happy. Because Guild Wars 1 fans, specifically, I would think, really felt like they deserved to see this story, and a good deal of them, or a good deal of people, I guess, are not raiders. And so they feel like the story is locked off from them. And that's a whole separate conversation that I don't really want to get into. But my point about this is, if this is the only way for ArenaNet to tell some of these loose ends, some of these stories, then would you rather them not tell them, or would you rather them be told in raids? Because for whatever reason, it doesn't appear that there's sort of this whole philosophy of ArenaNet has a story that they want to tell in Guild Wars 2, and some of these loose ends don't fit within that story. So if you want those loose stories told, these extra stories told, then they're going to get told mostly through raids, it sounds like. Maybe fractals to an extent, and I know a lot of people were like, ah, this should have been told in fractals. This really would have worked well as a fractal, but you know, they came on Guild Chat and said, if we didn't really push for this to be the raid story, then we would not have told the story.
Well, yeah. I think I'm gonna echo Red Wolf in Chaz, tell the fucking stories. Like, I don't care. I dislike the idea that, like, with such a narratively driven game, that they have to fight to get a story told in the first place. I could understand this being a fractal, maybe, if they didn't have another, like, if they had another more cohesive raid plot put together, this could have been a fractal. Also, we've got raids, fractals, and current events, because reforging Caladbalg was a current event, and that's a fairly major side story. So we have multiple ways for side stories to get put into the game. And I don't want to ever miss out on plot.
Yeah.
And that's, I will... Oh, right? Sorry, go ahead.
That's what sort of worries and scares me a little bit, is that if they have to fight hard to get the Salt story to be the raid story, it just feels so... I don't know that narrow is the right word, but it feels narrow that we can't get away from whatever main story they're trying to tell.
I don't know. I think maybe the reason they chose this to try, I don't want to say shoehorn, because I don't know. Like, I'm not part of the narrative team. Maybe they were trying to push this because this is so White Mantle centric. Like, this is focusing a lot on White Mantle stuff, and that's kind of what the raid's been themed like so far.
Mm-hmm.
So perhaps that's why this has been focusing on that. This is, and it was a good way to showcase the, I guess you could say, the power of the eye, the power of the pointy rock. So
right, but then that begs the question, does this mean that the Eye of Janthir is not going to play any significant role within the living story itself, and we're only going to see it via raid stories in general?
I would actually think, because I think the Eye of Janthir could actually be part of living story, just because it is an entity that could be separate from side story, because... Unless the Eye of Janthir specifically involves Saul somehow, which would link back to the raid, I think it's okay if it's actually used in a personal story. Because it feels like a separate entity.
Honestly, not for this... Oh, go ahead.
Oh, no, go ahead, Dale.
I'll say, for this newest raid, it feels like the Eye of Janthir is going to be what Lazarus was for the first one. Where... it's going to bleed into the story. Where, like I said, I'm more fine with it because, like, kind of how you said, the Guild, like, probably Guild Wars 1 players were complaining because, oh, Saul main story. I'm like, I played Guild Wars 1, and I'm more fine with the Saul thing because it was never a main point in Guild Wars 1. They just said, oh, some, you know, he used to be a bunt. Like, you never met him. I met Lazarus in Guild Wars 1. That's why I was like, this is still the one that got away. Like, that's why it was so much more personal for me and, like, still was hard-hitting. And that's why I said even before when we were speculating on what this raid thing could be, I was like, if it involves Saul, it was before your time spent in Guild Wars 1. I'm fine with it. This is the prime example of them taking a side story from both Guild Wars 1 and 2 and filling it out and, you know, developing it. Whereas for me, it was like Lazarus. I was like, that was main story. Like that was a part of Guild Wars 1. Like that was.
Yeah, but it turns out that it's not even Lazarus.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, but Guild Wars 1 lore aside, I feel like the Lazarus story was a bit of a punch in the face because it was essentially a prequel to Living Story Season 3. Which I didn't agree with, but I feel like for Bastion of the Penitent, it was an open and shut story. It's a good story. It kind of tells a story that would not be told otherwise, like they said, and I think it was solid in that respect. So if they did more of that, I wouldn't be opposed to it at all.
And I agree with Chat about, you know, the idea of, like, not having a story instance version, but I would like to, like we said before, or like I kind of came up with before, of like, maybe if you know people that are raiders or that they can sell it, of like an Asuran recording device that will unlock, like, you can now go into this and watch, like, so you can see dialogues and stuff like that, if that's important to you. Because for me, I'm the type of person, like, I want to hear the dialogue of, like, how this person's saying that. I went back to listen to Gorsaval lines when they said it was, like, two voices and stuff. I was like, what kind of voices? Like, can I differentiate between the two? Like, maybe that gives me insight of what the spirits are. Like, granted, that probably means nothing. But as someone that wants to, like, dig through the lore and, like, maybe speculate on crazy ideas, I would do that. If I had one of those devices where I could go in there, that, like, maybe a raider that kills all the bosses and unlocks this gem, similar to, actually, in Guild Wars 1, you had those bonus mission packs. You could, you got a journal, and once you filled it out, you could trade a full journal in for a weapon. Well, maybe once you get this full journal, or this full device kitted out, you can actually sell it, or trade it, or whatever, to a player. That way it gives raiders, you know, an income after. But that's,
yeah, I mean,
going off on.
I don't know what the solution is, really. ArenaNet seems to be, currently anyway, they seem to be resistant to a story instance. Their solution so far has been to make the raid bosses, the exception of Deimos, easier in general. More forgiving, soft enrage timers, for example. They've put a couple of things in place where they've made the encounters, with the exception of CM, that's a different topic, but they've made the raid encounters in Wing 4 easier, except for the last boss.
Mm-hmm.
They don't seem to be going the story mode, at least not currently. So I don't know what the solution is for that exactly. I know that players want a story mode raid instance. I've sort of been resistant to it. But
even
if enough people want it, then I think that they'll eventually give it to them. I just don't think they'll retrofit raids for it, though.
Yeah.
Even personally, even as just kind of a mini cinematic that you can trigger, that they do a pre-shot thing using their free cam, like someone on like an 11th account, dev tools and all that good stuff, is doing a flyover of a random like assortment of 10 player characters. Like they set it up and, you know, it's them running through and it shows quick cuts wherever the dialogue would be in. Like, you skip the fights because there's really not much story in the fights. But, you know, like, you have the group walking through the tunnel after Veil Guardian, and, you know, you start talking, you hear the talk about the spirits.
Right.
And then you move into the next area, and it's like, and then, you know, the talk about after, like, whenever there's chatter, there's a little cut of, like, the people walking through, like, they're actually the group of mercenaries that infiltrated the area to recover the Pact Squadron. So that would be something that I think would be a good idea. And then you can just talk to somebody in the raid hub in Lion's Arch and be like, hey, what happened here?
Spectator mode for raiding. It's an interesting concept.
I would love it if you could run through the run through a cleared instance and Glenna would be run along with you and would describe the events that happened there.
Right.
And then there'd be like hologram thing.
And I think all of those ideas work, with the exception, and I could be wrong, there might be some dialogue during the other bosses I just can't quite recall. It's interesting, when you're fighting a boss, especially for the first time, Deimos is, Saul tells his story while you're fighting Deimos. I'm not listening to Saul. Sorry, Saul, I would love to listen to your interesting facts about life, but the many tiny hand demon is trying to kill me. I don't have time to listen to your story. And, you know, that doesn't mean I don't like it or want it removed, but it's one of those things where that's what players want to experience. They want to hear that dialogue, and that's why they want a story mode, right? They want to be able to experience that while it's happening. But I don't know exactly how you do that. Like, let's say Glenna escorts you through the instance, which I think is a pretty good idea. And you get to, let's say, in Spirit Veil, you get to the ghost wall or whatever you want to call it. And your character, as you progress through the raid instances in all of the wings, makes little comments here and there. And those little comments is what you sort of miss out on when you're going into a cleared instance, which is like the current option. And I think that's what some players want. And in some of the boss fights, Deimos specifically, but I think there might be some others, your character or NPCs make some comments while the fight is happening, and that's the kind of stuff that you sort of miss. I'm sure there's a way that they can implement that. I'm sure that there's a solution there as well, but
I would
something to keep in consideration.
I would have like Glenna have like a memory hologram type of deal, and then maybe you can play some of that back when you reach a certain point. Like if you reach Deimos fight, you would like play back the hologram a little bit, and then make you can like hear Saul's story throughout that part. I don't know how well that would go, depending on what's said during the fight, what your player character says during the fights, and as you traverse through everything. It is kind of hard to fully simulate that without going like full story mode, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and Crichton Herald says that the Forsaken Thicket is large enough to be made into a normal map. There could be things to interact with on the map, which there are things to interact with, which do tell us. I mean, that's where the bulk of the story is for Spirit Veil, is in these little things. It's not so much even in the fights or whatever, but
yeah, it's what was Raid Wing 3? No, 2. That's Forsaken Thicket, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because Stronghold of the Faithful is 3.
Yes.
So in Forsaken Thicket, there's like a lot of diaries and stuff that are floating around.
And burn like, pit.
Yeah,
so those things do exist. That's what's funny about... it wasn't until Wing 4 that we got really more kind of evolved story. The other wings... Wing 3 was a little involved, I guess, with the end scene. But a lot of it is through journal pages and items that you interact with and stuff like that. And it would be cool that if you went into a cleared instance, that could still be triggered. I'm sure there's a way they can figure out a way to like trigger that stuff. Like H said, maybe Glenna can escort you and give me a tour, Glenna.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, H. Walk with me.
Well, Glenna's going to walk with you. I'm going to kill bosses. I want loots.
Yeah. Well, and I think... Jim KG, that's why we're trying to figure out of a way that's it's not a story mode where they have to revamp the fights. Like, it's almost like a replaying of the... Like, almost kind of how Katie was saying, a spectator mode, but in a, you know, different way.
Yeah, this would be like a completely empty instance. It would be like traveling through a completed instance.
I think there's a way to deliver on some of these ideas with just reworking how the instance works. This doesn't necessarily mean that you need to pull devs from other places. It's just that they need to design the raid instance itself slightly differently.
And it would be better to address this now.
Adding trigger points into the instance, I don't know that you necessarily need to, you know, have an entire team work on that. I think that can be done by simply designing the raid instance around it a little better. That's all. Little tweaks, I think, to how it currently works could satisfy those players looking for the story. If you're talking about creating a story mode or an entirely separate instance, then sure, that is a lot more work and that's a lot more involved. But I think that there are ways to add trigger points to retell a cleared instance or something that doesn't require like a full rework of a map or something.
Well, let's talk about where we think the story might go. Because we're already like 2 hours in, but...
Give me Livia.
Well, the Eye of Janthir is active.
and doing things. So it, from what I understand, it just kind of poofs away at the end of the raid. Lazarus is not actually Lazarus, which means that Lazarus... Actually, no, he probably can't be resummoned because the blood, they'd have to blow up another bloodstone to do it for, like, the real White Mantle. So the only people who would be in charge of the Eye of Janthir are not here. So what the hell is the Eye doing? Who the hell is Lazarus? And to be, what the hell do they want?
Who does fake Lazarus want? Or what does fake Lazarus want?
Who is fake Lazarus, and what does fake Lazarus want?
Who is your dad, and what does he do?
Exactly.
yeah, it's interesting. It's whoever fake Lazarus is has to be a being that can absorb a bloodstone hit. How many people can absorb a bloodstone hit?
Depends on how it was done, I suppose.
Unless they have, like, secret seer technology that absorbed the hit and they didn't actually take the hit like we suppose they did.
Yeah.
It could be some, you know, misdirection there.
Would have had to be, like, somebody faking themselves as Lazarus's body inside of his tomb during the ritual. It would have had to be somebody in the White Mantle, I would think.
It's interesting because there's... whoever E is could be fake Lazarus. But then a lot of times I think people, myself included, sort of assume E is human. But I think it's less and less likely that that's true.
I'll say he has a love for Christ.
He or she has a love for humanity.
Yes.
Also is potentially in the Order of Whispers.
Or certainly has connections to the Orders, or the Order of Whispers in general, but I think probably all of the Orders. They have their hands in many pies, it would seem.
Mm-hmm.
They have spies all over the place. They're like the, what is the character from Game of Thrones? The spider, or whatever his name is. He's got little birds. My little birds tell me all over. Yeah, his little birds. The little birds tell fake Lazarus or tell E all of the secrets of Kryta.
Now, I do remember that name, the Envoys.
Eris, thank you.
Who are they?
The Envoys, because what's his name from Factions? Shiro was actually an Envoy. They basically helped, I think, collect the dead, kind of a thing.
Yeah.
And he went rogue.
Yeah, more or less.
Okay. Also, the whole Casimir could be fake Lazarus.
I don't think so.
Yeah, it's seeming less and less.
Why? How does that make sense?
Explain
the logic to me, please.
Mesmer.
that's how it works. Yeah, I don't know. I know some people are saying it could be Eve. They want a niece to be fake Lazarus, who is also Livia. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know. I think that there's a story there where the Scepter of Ur can absorb like a bloodstone hit or something. Maybe there's something to be said about using an Eye of Janthir to prolong your life, to keep you alive while you take the bloodstone hit. All those things seem kind of reachy to me. Could fake Lazarus be a seer? I keep confusing the races. Is it the seers? The Mursaat? What were the races?
The original five were Jotun, seers, Mursaat, dwarves, and forgotten.
So is it a seer? Is it a seer playing fake Lazarus? Is E a seer? Maybe. Why does that seer care about humanity? I don't know.
E is definitely intriguing. I'm very curious of who it might be. A lot of people also kind of try to point to possibly Livia, and I think it is a surprising note, or that whole stem of like Anise is Livia, or maybe E is somehow involved in this, because there are parallels with E, especially with some of the letters. When we were talking about how Anise was not trusting in E's report of, you know, I've received a report, the Blade and the Seraph guards, you know, take this to the Whispers, how you were talking about headquarters, to, you know, catch them up, we're going to need all the help we can get, Whispers protocol, blah, blah, blah. Codicus is a traitor to Kryta, involve no Beetle Stones until we confirm where their loyalties lie, which,
right,
to me, was. So it kind of has that parallel to what Anise was saying, but also with one of the letters, kind of like how we were saying how E loves humanity. You know, if Divinity's Reach falls, Kryta falls. And if Kryta falls, humanity falls. Do not fail us. Your mission is clear. Find Codicus. He must be eliminated with prejudice. Like, that could very much be a Livia thing. Like, she was very Kryta-centric and was...
Ivenia?
I've heard people bring up Ivenia before. Ivenia makes sense, right?
I'm curious of who the, like basically Aya Janthir, who was Janthir? Was it just the location, or was it named after someone?
Wait, who knows?
I know. Air. Oh, boy.
But we pressed F to pay respects.
Yeah, if it worked for Lazarus, can we do it for Air? Just need to blow up a bloodstone, right? That should be easy. Because I've of course, you know, I try to relate everything back to Abaddon. well,
poor dead Abaddon.
I need notes for this.
Yeah, poor. I love when people say he's dead. The devs have said that. The devs always said whatever the point of the at the time the story is. They're not going to be like, oh yeah, no, he's actually alive, even though you just killed him. Like, they're never gonna give you a spoiler. But granted, you know.
I love your optimism.
Well,
I think Scarlet's still alive.
Oh, where's I the...
think she's gonna, well, I don't think she's alive. I think she's gonna come back. Sorry.
Well, like I said, this is a picture of the Aya Janthir in the raid, and like you might be able to see the starry pattern behind it. Chat's yelling at me. And I said this during one of the after shows. There's a starry pattern with what looks like an Aya Janthir already in game. We have seen a mural of it, which is the picture of the All. And around it is in Ascalonian, I believe, beware of secrets kept, I think, something along those lines. But that statue, or that mural, is under the Abaddon statue. Now, remember, Abaddon was the god of secrets. Maybe he inherited it, but he did inherit it. From who? We don't know. His predecessor. Why was this predecessor so bad that they had to remove him? Like, that's where I'm interested now.
So what you're saying is it's possible that whatever elder god Abaddon got his godhood from, like Cormyr took over for him,
right,
could be resurfacing?
I mean, I think we destroyed Abaddon, but we put Cormyr in there. I think Cormyr might eventually be corrupted or already corrupted.
I will admit, I kind of like Crichton Herald's statement on this. The dev said we weren't going to Lake Doric.
Yeah.
Well, okay.
Yeah.
They said we weren't getting that Lake Doric map, which we didn't get. Yeah, it's wordplay, I understand. But I think that... I think there's a possibility for Abaddon lore. In other words, what his secret was, or things that he knew about how magic works. But I don't necessarily believe that we're going to see a resurgence of Abaddon or Abaddon's former master.
Well, We don't know what happened to his former master. That's the thing. I don't think we're going to see Abaddon come back, but I think it's going to be like, he was right all along, or he was still teaching us type of thing. But if you think about it, Abaddon in Guild Wars 1, Nightfall, all of it was his realm bleeding into the world through rifts or through other things. And he also kind of had a direct relation to the Scepter of Or, which now possibly is in Olivia's hands or who knows, but had that, you know, connection with that. There is another tool out there that's the parallel to that, and it is the Staff of the Mists. There's like only one quest in Guild Wars 1 about it, but basically it's the sister weapon to the Scepter of Or. Supposedly it can control reality, blah 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 blah. But if it's the Staff of the Mists and possibly can go to other dimensions, which we are going to the, you know, the Fractal, the Mists, you know, War of the Worlds, the Mists, all the, you know, what's happening in Tyria and Ascalon right now? Anomalies, all these things. What if we're seeing kind of the parallel version of what Abaddon was going through, of this whatever bleeding into our world? Now we're seeing the Staff of the Mists connect who whatever it stems to, bleeding into Tyria.
Not to derail you too much, but you know what would be cool if they do bring the Scepter of Or and the Staff of the Mists, which I had totally forgotten about it. You just mentioned it. If they do bring those back into the game, or if they do tie those back into the game somehow, I would love it if those were the legendary staff. Oh, no, we already have a staff. Damn it, that already doesn't work. Well, the Scepter of War could still be a legendary scepter.
Yeah, there you go, scepter. Hey, you know, if you equip, Emberglow, it looks pretty staff-like. It's a pretty long one, so there you go, scepter.
Honestly, I'd be kind of okay with that, but that gets into talk about, you know, how they're treating legendaries now, and I don't think getting the Scepter of Or as a legendary item
via that you just the way it.
Yeah, with the way the current legendary, the new legendary crafting system is, I don't want to see that, I'd rather see it be another ascended weapon a la Kalibolg at this point, because that's way better than the current system for legendaries.
Yeah, and definitely I could see there being a if it somehow is reintroduced, I could see a side current event that could deal with something like that. Of course, that means it would be an ascended weapon and not legendary, but it could still look cool and it could still be meaningful. I mean, Kalibolg is way more meaningful to me than any legendary I've ever made, really.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, that's getting off topic again.
And you're right, Hat. The Scepter of War was a staff, but we're just saying so it could work. But, hey, maybe they'll do the greatsword thing with the staffs. Maybe you have to combine things to make, you know, greatsword had two legendaries, or three. So, hey, they can have more than one, you know? Especially if it's cool like that and can do it justice, because I agree with Jim. That would be my one worry.
You throw the Staff of the Mists, the Scepter of War, and Bifrost into the Mystic Forge, along with a stack of ectoplasm. Get out something else.
You do it in the wrong order, you sink ore.
Again.
But no, that, you know, I'd like to see it go back to the gods, but we are kind of on the dragon story, I guess.
I hate to rush you out of lore talk, but
no, we're going 2.5 hours. I mean, any other thoughts, ideas, or?
I think that we'll have to revisit it.
Yeah. Because I think most of the people that were clamoring for lore either had connection issues or was getting late for them, so. But more than likely, we'll still be talking during after show. I know we want to revisit the item level thing. And like Ink says, we'll probably revisit it, so. But, yeah, let us do some outro. So, Jim, where can you be found?
I can be found on Twitter, @MalthanusMMO. You can also find me here on twitch.tv/TalkingScrit every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for our Zero to Hero PvP night. Look for a poll going up on my Twitter, probably going to be Monday morning, For the remainder of the two classes that I need to actually play, it'll be either Revenant or Thief. So I get to watch myself fail at another set of classes. So, you know, come out, join the fun, vote on the poll.
Awesome, awesome. Age, where can you be found?
Twitch and YouTube at Age Night Erd. I will sadly be going into the Condi Fest that is PvP next week, so...
remove. Cleanse.
That'll be fun.
Awesome.
Thief games.
And Inks, where can you be found?
You guys can find me Twitch, Twitter, YouTube at MMO Inks. Nice and simple.
Awesome, awesome. And you can find me at simply_day on Twitch, Twitter, YouTube. I don't know if I'm playing D&D tonight, but we did put out one of the last other episodes that had to be kind of delayed. If you go watch it, you'll probably see why things got a little bit heated. Hopefully we play that and continue to put out more for you guys. Possibly play Wildlands this week coming out. Looks like a good game. But you can find us if you're popping at the very end. We do put this up on our YouTube. Just search Talking Script. We're usually the first one that pops up. That goes up Sundays at noon Eastern, 9 a.m. Pacific. If you're watching on YouTube, like I said, we're going to continue the conversation after show. If you can show up live, Saturdays at 4 p.m. Eastern, 1 p.m. Pacific. And as always, we will see you in the game. All right, everybody.